This week on Cracked Science, psychedelic drugs can help treat mental illness. Or can they? We take a data-driven acid trip down the rabbit hole to find out. Hey, this is Jonathan Jerry, and you're watching Cracked Science, a show from the McGill Office for Science and Society that separates sense from nonsense on the scientific stage. I have been asked more than once if there is any credible evidence for the use of magic mushrooms, LSD, or ecstasy in treating mental illness. And in order to answer that question, we need to go back to Bicycle Day. And no, I don't mean Dutch people's favorite holiday, which they celebrate year-round. In 1943, chemist Albert Hofmann accidentally ingested trace amounts of a substance he had discovered and synthesized a few years before. That chemical was LSD. He thought, oh, that's quite intriguing. And so 3 days later, on April 19th, Hofmann deliberately ingested what we now know to be a powerful dose of the drug. He started getting dizzy, anxious, feeling the need to laugh, and as his trip became more and more disturbing, he asked his assistant to accompany him home, and they rode their bicycles together because the war effort had put restrictions on automobile use. Wait, that's why it's called Bicycle Day? That's what we're supposed to remember from this, that because of the war they had to ride bicycles? Bicycle Day? Oh look, it's the day when two people rode their bikes together. No, it was, oh my god, this scientist is tripping on acid for the very first time and thinks he's dying day. Which is why I don't name holidays. LSD is a psychedelic, a mind-revealing drug, a category that also includes magic mushrooms and ecstasy. And for 20 years, from the mid-40s to the mid-60s, scientists were self-experimenting with them, presenting about them at scientific conferences, and a pharmaceutical company like Sandoz was actually manufacturing them, specifically LSD and psilocybin. But in the second half of the 60s, these drugs gained a bad reputation. They were seen as dangerous and likely to cause addiction. In 1970, President Nixon signed the Controlled Substances Act, and this had a significant impact on scientific research because these drugs could not practically be studied anymore, as by definition, they were seen as having no accepted medical use and lacking the safety necessary to be used under medical supervision. But societies change, and now we are in the midst of what has been called a psychedelic renaissance, which sounds like an alternate universe in which Michelangelo painted the Sistine Chapel ceiling while high on ayahuasca. What it actually means is that some people claim that these mind-altering substances could have a beneficial impact on mental illness, like post-traumatic stress disorder.
I was, you know, hypervigilant. I was always on alert, like wondering, like, when's the next attack going to be? It's like the mind couldn't register. You're back home. You're safe. The MDMA removes that blockage of fear of wanting to deal with these issues. For me, like, I was able to realize, like, this is the past.
Nearly 10% of Canadians will develop post-traumatic stress disorder, or PTSD, at some point in their lives. And you don't need to go to war to have it. It can be caused by the unexpected death of a loved one, seeing someone killed, or being sexually assaulted. And many people are quick to point out that the current standard of care, which includes antidepressants and therapy, doesn't work for everyone. The therapy, by the way, is often prolonged exposure therapy, the idea being that the patient relives their trauma in a safe context to learn to dissociate the memory from the threat. But you can imagine that reliving a trauma over and over again is not everyone's cup of tea. If you're liberal-minded, imagine having a weekly therapy session in which you have to watch this recording over and over again.
This means that Donald Trump will be the 45th president of the United States, winning the most unreal, surreal election we have ever seen.
I'm afraid our hour is up. That'll be $120. See you next week. There is reason to believe that MDMA, also known as ecstasy, could help with PTSD. And the theory is, at first, the warm feeling of wanting to hug everyone might increase trust in your therapist. But second, MDMA may act at a level of the brain to tame its exaggerated responses to trauma, namely by decreasing the activity of the amygdala and increasing its inhibition through the prefrontal cortex. Now, this is all fine and dandy, having a theory as to how all this is supposed to work, but without evidence to back it up, it's not worth much. I may think that if I jump from the rooftop of this building and wave my arms around very quickly, I'll fly like the birds that I see doing the same thing, but clearly, superficial plausibility is not enough. There have been two randomized clinical trials done recently on the use of MDMA to treat PTSD, one from an American team and one from Switzerland. And it's important to point out that they don't just give patients ecstasy and tell them to go home and take it as needed. This is an 8-hour session. It requires two therapists in the room, an overnight stay, and a number of sober psychotherapy sessions before and after to prepare the patient for the experience and to help them make sense of it afterwards. Both trials recruited people with PTSD who had had symptoms on average for almost 20 years, with conventional treatment being inadequate. In the American trial, 83% of the people who got the MDMA improved significantly, whereas only 25% of the people who got a sugar pill improved. Using the same improvement assessment method, the Swiss trial did not see a significant difference. And it's important to note that none of these trials compare the psychedelic-assisted psychotherapy to standard of care. Now, there are a number of problems with these trials. They are pilot studies, and as such, they can only give us a flavor of what the truth may be. In the American trial, 12 people got the MDMA. In the Swiss one, it was 8. Also, most of the participants were women who had been sexually assaulted or had experienced childhood abuse, so they may not be representative of everyone with PTSD. Also, the placebo in the US study was a sugar pill, but pretty much everyone figured out what they got, so in Switzerland, the placebo was a small dose of MDMA, which wasn't completely inert and actually made some participants worse in the moment, which required more intervention from the psychotherapists. So you start to see how complex these studies are and how difficult it is to figure out if the stuff works or not when funding is an issue. There's still a lot of stigma around these drugs, and they are off patent, so pharmaceutical companies are not willing to foot the bill for the studies. So the organization that funded both trials, the Multidisciplinary Association for Psychedelic Studies, or MAPS, had to resort to donations from individuals and corporations. Studies on MDMA and PTSD, but also on LSD and anxiety, and magic mushrooms and addiction, they are small. They have interesting early findings, but the jury is still out on whether or not they really do work. And some people are worried about the potential harm of using these drugs in a therapeutic setting. But as MAPS reports, spontaneously reported reactions are typically observed during drug administration, but are transient and diminish as a drug is metabolized and excreted over the next 24 hours, with the majority of reactions resolving within several days and up to 1 week after dosing. And while chronic use of these substances can have a negative impact on our health, the kind of psychotherapy that is being studied uses a single dose, or two or three. So, in short, there is very preliminary evidence that some psychedelics, when integrated into a therapeutic environment, could help deal with certain mental disorders, but it is still too early to call it. We need larger studies. And even if psychedelic-assisted psychotherapy becomes routine, there are questions that will need to be answered, such as what happens if a therapist refuses you another dose because their objective assessment is that it's not working, but you think it's working, and you end up buying adulterated ecstasy from a street dealer and turning into a habitual drug user? Or what happens when you get the bill for an 8-hour therapy session involving two well-paid therapists and an overnight stay? But there is hope that one day we may get to relive our trauma in a beige room, lying on a beige couch while high on ecstasy. Until then, I hate to be square, but more studies are needed. I know I make a lot of jokes on the show, but sometimes our brain misbehaves and we need to reach out to someone, and that's no joke. So if you think you may have a drug dependency, or that your relationship to food is causing you serious problems, or you think you have PTSD, or you're having some very dark thoughts, there are people out there who want to listen to you and help. The CTV News website has a page dedicated to suicide and crisis hotlines all over the country. There are national crisis hotlines. There are resources like Bell's Let's Talk initiative, as well as provincial helplines. Just scroll through it and see what works for you. Link in the description down below. If you can't find it, just Google mental health care in Canada, where to find help. If you haven't subscribed to our YouTube channel, do click that button and ring that bell to get notifications. Don't forget to join the thousands of people who subscribe to our weekly newsletter by going to mcgill.ca/OSS. In the meantime, you can follow me on Twitter @crackedscience and join us next time for science that may or may not be all it's cracked up to be.